Good evening and welcome to Horizon. I'm Ted Simons. Republican presidential candidates Mitt Romney and Michelle Bachmann were campaigning in Arizona today. Romney released a list of high-profile Arizonans who are supporting his candidacy. Bachmann met with Maricopa County Sheriff Joe Arpaio, who has yet to endorse a presidential candidate. Motivational speaker James Arthur Ray will not be getting a new trial. A Yavapai County judge turned down that request earlier today. Ray awaits sentencing following his June 22nd conviction on three counts of negligent homicide. Three people died following a sweat lodge ceremony at a retreat Ray sponsored near Sedona in 2009. The Arizona Court of Appeals will take a look at the state's Medicaid enrollment freeze. A trial judge recently ruled that the legislature does not have to fund a voter-approved law that increased eligibility for the state's access program. Public interest law firms disagreed with that ruling, and a hearing now is set for next month. And Governor Brewer wants a lawsuit challenging her Day of Prayer proclamations dismissed. A Wisconsin-based group is behind the challenge. The governor says their group lacks standing in the case, with the governor noting that her days of prayer are voluntary events. A similar challenge against a national Day of Prayer was thrown out. Well, for 10 years now, the Northern Arizona Center for Entrepreneurship and Technology has helped create jobs in the high-tech industry by linking businesses with human and capital resources, as well as with labs and networking within the high-tech area. NACET recently expanded by opening a new office at the Embry-Riddle Aeronautical University in Prescott. Here to talk about NACET in general and the expansion in particular is Russ Yelton. He's president and CEO of the organization. Good to have you here. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Give us a more detailed explanation of what NACET does and is.
NACET is a high-tech business incubation program that seeks companies that have technologies that they're trying to commercialize both domestically and internationally, and make sure that they understand the markets that they're going into, have appropriate capital and appropriate workforce.
So you're basically helping startups is what you guys.
Yes.
Transforming innovation into business. It's a good catch line. What does it mean?
It means we get to see a lot of things, some interesting, some not so interesting. We're really looking for technologies that will have a major impact. So, for example, one of our clients, Nest Energy, builds advanced light trailers that includes advanced wind and solar technologies that's currently replacing diesel generators in places like Afghanistan and Iraq for the military. So being able to take those types of innovations and put them to market.
Yeah, let's get some examples here of linking clients to specialty labs and linking these clients to equipment. What do we talk? Give us an example.
We've recently started a core laboratory in the incubator of higher-end equipment that companies may not be able to afford or to purchase. So, for example, we have a 1000X microscope that can actually take a penny, flip it over, we can measure the distance between the columns on the back of the Lincoln Memorial and digitize that. So, for companies that are working on chip technologies, access to this can be extremely expensive. We're able to provide that for $65 an hour.
And as far as intellectual property, how does that fit in here?
Yes, most of our companies do have intellectual property, and we help them develop their intellectual property strategies as well as the commercialization strategies for those technologies.
You kind of referred to this earlier, but capital resources as well. That's a big deal, isn't it?
It really is. Access to capital can be a huge barrier for companies. In 2009, 2010, our companies raised just under $50 million in capital to push those technologies into the markets.
And is that improving? Is it still a tough sell? How's the climate out there?
Well, the term sheets are very different than they were 3 or 4 years ago, so it's not uncommon for us to advise a client not to accept capital. But you know, that being said, we really want them to bootstrap the company as much as possible so they retain as much equity as they can. Currently, this year, our clients have received just over $22 million in funding.
Is it easier because there's so much focus on high tech, or is that a tougher sell, as is everything these days?
No, it is easier because it is focused on high tech. These companies are, many of them are focused on what we call a disruptive technology, a technology that can really have an impact not only within the U.S., but also internationally.
The having faculty, having staff there at Embry-Riddle, and just up at NAU, mm-hmm. having these folks around, talk about the impact there.
It's really huge. We assist NAU with their tech transfer activities, and being able to have access to the labs and the knowledge to link people that have business ideas to those resources at the university, and then to have the ability to have resources and ideas being created at the university and intellectual property that the businesses can then license out is very important.
And mentors and alumni as well, I think, a big factor as well?
Absolutely. We have almost 50 volunteers in our mentors group. These are IP attorneys, CPAs, marketing experts, other people that donate several hours a month of pro bono time to our clients.
Is it hard to get these folks to donate? Because sometimes we hear that people just aren't willing to mentor like they should be.
You know, it's really not. We actually have a mentor, Ron Kosicki, who's an IP attorney in Scottsdale, that drives to Flagstaff two times a month just to hang out in our building and be around all the startups.
The impact as well of partnering with high-tech firms, but with low-tech firms as well. Talk about that dynamic.
Yeah, it's important. For example, we can have firms using lab technicians in labs that need a certain level of training. So they may have the IP, but we need to have an appropriately trained workforce. So one of our partnerships is with Coconino Community College in ensuring programs like SolidWorks, which is advanced CAD simulation software, is actually done appropriately so we have the workforce for the companies.
And again, this is based around expertise and based around technology, correct?
Yes.
Student Business Incubation Program. I read about this and thought that sounds like a great idea. I know a lot of universities and a lot of colleges are trying to do this. How are you guys doing this?
We actually have a program now. We take students. They can qualify for a $5,000 business grant if they're accepted into the program, and then they're immersed in the program for a period of 12 months. Recently, we had two students at Embry-Riddle Aeronautical University get accepted. These two gentlemen were phenomenal. They were in the intelligence area. They each learned five different languages and start a company that does intelligence scraping on the internet.
Interesting. Yeah. Up there at Embry-Riddle,
yes.
Huh? Speaking of Embry-Riddle, why Prescott? Why Embry-Riddle?
You know, there's a certain interesting amount of intellectual capital around all universities, Embry-Riddle in particular. Our current facility was funded partially by an EDA grant in Flagstaff, but it requires that for us to be regional in scope. So now that the program in Flagstaff is full and is running very well, it was time to expand, and it was just a natural progression to choose Prescott and Embry-Riddle.
Are you seeing, especially with the things like the student incubation programs, are you seeing in Flagstaff and now hoping to see and perhaps already seeing in Prescott, the idea of, we were talking earlier about a brain drain going
yes.
on in certain areas of the country, certain areas of the state, Flagstaff in particular, maybe
yes.
even Prescott as well. Is this helping alleviate that?
That is definitely part of the goal, that we, you know, take people in the area, we give them the resources that they need and the support to be successful and create jobs. And at the end of the day, that's our mission. In 2009, 2010, we documented 165 new jobs being created by our companies. And these are primarily higher tech jobs with average salaries around $75,000.
And primarily these folks are sticking around town.
Yes.
Be it Flagstaff or Prescott.
Definitely, yeah. And for a lot of folks, it's a lifestyle choice. They want to raise their families in northern Arizona and be in the area. And so by linking the things that they need to grow their businesses and be successful, we have a much greater chance of retaining them.
What are you seeing? And let's concentrate on northern Arizona and central Arizona and the Prescott and Flagstaff areas. Does it seem like the improvements in high tech, both the industry, the innovation as well, are you seeing that happening? Is it a slow groundswell? Is it something that's flashing? What's going on?
Well, you know, in the last 2.5 years, we've gone from 9 to 34 companies in our program. What we're seeing is a lot of people who may have taken early retirement in Flagstaff, Sedona, the Prescott area, who play golf for 6 months and get bored, and they want to get back into business. And so by having ties to the universities, intellectual property coming out of those universities, and a well-trained workforce, there's really a lot of opportunity.
Yeah, there's a lot of attraction to those areas, and you
yes.
can kind of bank on that as well.
Absolutely.
Good to have you here. Thanks
Thank
for
you.
Joining us.
Appreciate it.